Good afternoon. We are going to see a very exciting mode of therapy in medicine, that is coronary angioplasty. From surgery to no surgery was a huge jump in treating coronary artery disease, and it has evolved to perfection. Now it is at a stage where most of the lesions and most of the complex anatomies can be treated by coronary angioplasty. This is just a romantic version of the coronaries, which looks like the heart. And this is my own hand-drawn diagram, which shows you it arises from the aortic sinuses, the right coronary artery to your left, and the left main divides into two arteries, which is going behind, and also left anterior descending, which is coming in front of the heart. Generally, when we draw pictures, they are looking like this, wherein the right coronary artery at the crux divides into two branches. Left main divides into LCX circumflex and LAD, and then it has its own branches. Most of the times, the heart will have three major arteries and maybe one or two side branches. So five major branches to each heart constitute the coronary blood supply. And this is how angioplasty takes place. There is a plaque, a wire is passed through that. The wire is that 0.014 inch. Balloon expands and compresses the plaque to the side. The balloon is then removed, and on the same wire comes in a stent and balloon assembly. The balloon expands, leaves the stent behind under high pressure. Stent implantation is complete, and that is how angioplasty gets done. Atheroma, the plaque that you saw, is like a cheese. It's a little tougher than the cheese. Maybe it is a fibrofatty substance, and it can get compressed to the side by the plastic balloon that we use. These are tiny balloons made of 2 millimeters or 3.5 millimeter diameter, and they are under high pressure, the pressure that is required to inflate a double-decker bus tire. So it goes up to 12 bars or 13 bars pressure, by which the atheroma is compressed to the side as a thin film. And on this well-prepared bed, the stent is deployed with a balloon. If the bed is not yielding, then we have to cut the calcium by using maybe a rotablator or maybe a cutting balloon or some devices, and then you implant the stent in place. You can see a nice looking lesion right at the top. It could be constituting about 80 to 90%. And after deployment of the stent, you can see a wonderfully opened up artery. I'm sure the person's angina goes away, and the chances of heart attack also diminish significantly. This is a wonder treatment, and a person who performs it probably is in cloud nine when a successful angioplasty gets performed. It has evolved wonderfully over a period of years. First, it was done in 1976 in Switzerland by Andrea Grunzig. In India, it came to 1985. Bare metal stenting, because before that it was only balloon angioplasties, came in India at 1994, drug-eluting stent by 2002-2003, and absorbable stent, which is a wonder by itself, in 2013. But we are now at the fourth generation stent, which are drug-eluting, and they are wonder devices. So we moved from bare metal stents to alloy stents, drug-eluting stents where the drug got changed, delivery patterns got changed, polymer-free stents, abluminal coating, and the stent designs also evolved based on the customer comfort, that is the cardiologist comfort, and of course, the success rate that had to be improved. A stent when implanted, the fourth generation drug-eluting stent, the endothelialization is over within 1 month. That means you can afford to stop the dual antiplatelet therapy as early as 1 month. We don't do it though, but it can be done if a surgery or something is planned. We said that there are four types of drugs. These are all anti-malignancy drugs. Delivery is in the intima and the media over a period of about 30 to 60 days, and they prevent what is called as neo-intimal hyperplasia. The biodegradable stent came about 4 years ago and made a definite curiosity and lots of enthusiasm related to you implant a stent And at the end of 1 year, there will be no stent at all. But unfortunately, it had its problems after 3 years of use. And that's why we are back to using the fourth generation stent. This is how the bioabsorbable stent looks. And once it is implanted, within a span of 1 year or so, it completely disappears, dissolves completely. So you are left behind with a normal artery, which is supple, elastic, responds to drugs, and behaves like normal artery. It responds physiologically to exercise and other aspects of it. It was a fascinating discovery after 10 years of a lot of engineering and research. Unfortunately, went into disrepute after 3 years of use. But the discovery or the idea is not given up. Things are working on it. And in the future, we will have absorbable stent making ways into the coronary artery. In general, what are the principle is the vessel supplies moderate to large area of myocardium stands to reason. Person should have clinical angina or documented by a stress test, a thallium stress, a stress echo, or maybe fractional flow reserve, which is FFR, an invasive way of looking at coronary ischemia. About 80% lesion is there in chronic stable angina, we can stent, and milder lesions are stented in acute coronary syndrome, especially if it is ulcerated or has caused an event. So it's nature's indication to us to be aggressive and stent lesions which have caused acute coronary syndrome. By and large, the indications for PCI, percutaneous coronary intervention, are if the person has failure of medical line of treatment, that is angina, despite medical treatment, somebody has documented unstable angina, he is asymptomatic, but a very proximal LAD, a large area is involved. A person who is asymptomatic, maybe after a myocardial infarction, a lesion severity, if there is no contraindication to dual antiplatelet therapy, because the cornerstone of post-PCI management is giving dual antiplatelet therapy at least for 1 year. And if a person has contraindications for that, then angioplasty will have to be rethinked. There is a score called a syntax score, which is based on calcium, bifurcations, lesion severity, lesion tortuosity. And if this score is more than 28, then multivessel angioplasty is taken second seat compared to bypass surgery. But if the syntax score is less than 28, then even in multivessel disease, angioplasty could be preferred. If the myocardium is not viable, obviously, why are you going to do an angioplasty? If a person has a completely occluded artery, but it is very well collateralized, there is no LV dysfunction, there is not much of ischemia, then probably that total occlusion can be left alone. If FFR tells you the value of more than 0.8, then probably it is not an indication to do coronary angioplasty. So contraindications when the angioplasty started in the initial years was a bad calcific long lesion, high thrombus load inside the artery. You have a distal left main bifurcation, saphenous vein grafts, and in a cardiogenic shock situation, probably it was a contraindication then. But now it has got to a paradigm shift in 2018. Many contraindications, which were contraindications in 2000, now are actually prime indication. ST elevation MI, left main, bifurcation, saphenous vein, calcific lesions, chronic total occlusions, are all now treated right, left, and center by angioplasty. Now, in fact, it's a question of what not to do rather than what to do, because everything can be done. We have to think of what offers benefit to the patient rather than what would be the correct way of doing it. Type of lesion is divided into type 1, 2, 3, 4 based on the complexity and also on type ABC based on complexity. So the worst lesion would be 4C. And the best lesion will be 1A. So 1A is best for angioplasty, 4C is worse for angioplasty. This would be something like a 1A lesion, which could be treated easily by angioplasty. This also looks simple, but it is on a sharp bend, so it's not as easy as the first one. So it is a reasonably simple case. Then we have a total occluding, artery. The artery had to go straight down, but it's not going. So it's a totally occluded artery. And then we have a lesion which is very bad, maybe a type C lesion 3, calcification, total occlusion, diffuse disease. All these are happening into this lesion. So this is not a good case for angioplasty. This is a chronic total occlusion. The artery just cut off and you don't see anything beyond that. This is a tough challenge for an angioplaster. Before an angioplasty, the preparation is like any other procedure. You have to get an informed consent, check for contrast allergy, a spot HIV test, HBsAg test, hepatitis C, serum creatinine, hemoglobin, random sugar, probably all need to be done ideally. Intravenous antibiotic pre-procedure, just one shot is good enough. Soluble aspirin 325 milligrams, 300 milligrams of clopidogrel, or 180 milligrams of ticagrelor, or 60 milligrams of prasugrel are given based on the patient. Shaven, prepare the right radial on both groins, and of course, preferably nil by mouth for 3 hours before the procedure. The types of angioplasty are de novo lesions, which could be type A to C. PCI in acute MI is called PAMI. Bifurcation lesions, left main, chronic total occlusion, saphenous vein grafts. Angioplasty can be done through the Lima graft, or the approach could be transfemoral, right? This gentleman was in fact an ENT surgeon, just 43 years of age, came to us with an acute inferior wall myocardial infarction. And you can see that the artery is completely cut off. The moment a wire was passed down, the artery started, the flow started, but you can see a big chunk of thrombus, the negative shadow, which is seen near the bend. It was sucked out by the little dot that you see. It is a thrombosuction device. So it sucked out all the clot, and the clot looks like this. Actually, it's a tiny clot, about 2 to 3 millimeters, but it has blocked the artery and caused havoc with a myocardial infarction. After the thrombosuction, there is a discrete lesion that is seen, but no thrombus. It's so easy to stent this lesion, and it looks a beautiful new artery. The inferior wall is saved, and I'm sure the long-term prognosis of this gentleman is good because he came in good time. The door to balloon time was less than 90 minutes, and he got a result which was perfect. He had just one lesion, but somebody can come with a blocked artery and multiple other lesions. The other lesions should be treated in the same admission at the deferred stage. However, if the patient comes into cardiogenic shock, all the critical lesions should be treated at the time of the angioplasty. The next type of angioplasty is a bifurcation. It's a complex classification. Second from bottom is the Medina classification. That is what we generally use as 001-101 based on whether the main branch is involved or the side branch is involved. And various types of stenting. For example, you see the side branch stent is red, it is crushed, and the main stent is in the green, it is in the main branch. The side branch stent has come inside and both are overlapping in the main branch. It is called as a cool-out procedure. Or sometimes you can do what is called as a T stenting. The main branch is in the green and the T is coming from the red branch. And sometimes when the side branch is not diseased, you have to stent across into the main branch and the leading branch and leave the other branch alone. This type of stenting looking like a pajama is called as the V stenting, because for obvious reasons, you can make out why it is called V. And of course, you can see that this branch is completely occluded, one which is going down. It is a V kind of a lesion. And after that, when stenting is done, you can see that two stents and a beautiful V which has opened up the artery. So this kind of bifurcation stenting is also possible nowadays. When it comes to left main angioplasty, it could be right at the ostium, a very simple angioplasty to do, or a shaft, it is also simple to do. But when it comes to the second diagram, that is the distal bifurcation left main, it's takes a cardiologist worth its salt to do this kind of a bifurcation. It's a difficult technique. You have to be perfect in result. The chance of error is zero because if something goes wrong with the stent, it can result into sudden death. There could be left main equivalence. That means only the distal branches have proximal lesions and it looks like left main. For this also, we can use a V-stenting or a crush stenting or a simultaneous kissing technique called the SKS. Now, this lady had a distal left main bifurcation. You can see that the proximal artery is big and right at the origin, both those branches are critically diseased. In another view, it shows that you can see like a spider and both the branches are diseased at the origin. You put two wires, put two stents crisscross, or it's called as a bifurcation stenting. And this is how they look. And after everything is pulled out, look at the pleasing result of a left main distal bifurcation. Another challenging type of angiography is a saphenous vein graft. You know that it is anastomosed to the aorta and it is on the surface of the heart, the distal anastomosis. Suppose this is blocked, then you have to go inside. Saphenous veins become very friable and very delicate as years go by. So performing angioplasty is a very delicate game because if the vein graft perforates, it's a disaster. Here you can see a completely blocked saphenous vein graft. And you can see a wire wading its way through a totally occluded branch. We don't know what kind of a flow it is showing yet. But when you put in a stent, a pleasing flow is opened up and the native artery gets good flow. A stable plaque and an unstable plaque is a different ball game altogether. You can see on the top, it's an unstable plaque, lot of yellow fat globules, denuded intima, the blue line, lot of blood cells, platelets accumulated around the site, and of course, coronary spasm that goes along with it. Whereas one on the down is a stable plaque, there are not many fat globules, the blue cap is thick, and this person is extremely stable. Both lesions might be about 75%, but a stable lesion can be left alone probably on medical treatment, but an unstable lesion needs treatment with a stent, otherwise it will result into a myocardial infarction. So in an unstable lesion, even a moderate lesion which is ulcerated should be treated. Because the way to stabilize a plaque and prevent a myocardial infarction or an event is to stent and keep the high dose of statin to make it stable. You have to get rid of the thrombus, which is present in a soft lesion of acute coronary syndrome. And longer dual antiplatelet therapy is usually required for acute coronary syndrome. We generally have a low threshold for angioplasty in unstable angina. Because this lesion has caused an event, and if it left alone, it can result into a myocardial infarction. So we are more aggressive, even moderate 70% lesion, which has caused an MI or acute coronary syndrome. If it is ulcerated, it would be treated to achieve a good result. You can see that this one is called as an ulcerated lesion. Right in the center, the LAD looks as if it is torn. There are a lot of thrombus around. This lesion needs to be stented, even if it looks a mild lesion. Whereas in chronic stable lesions, our threshold for stenting is high. We must prove that this stable lesion is causing angina, either by way of FFR, IVUS, thallium, TMT, whichever way you can do it. And in the absence of documentation of ischemia, probably lesions are not stented. If a 90% stable lesion is there, then of course it should be stated straight away. You can see that this is a very stable lesion, no ulcer, no thrombus, and after stenting, it's a great angiographic result. About chronic stable angina, we always have a statement to ourselves that don't trouble the trouble unless the trouble troubles you. Because if you stent a stable lesion, the complications would be about 6% per year, and a stable lesion resulting into a myocardial infarction is just 3% per year. So generally, our threshold for stenting stable lesions is less. For example, this lesion, which looks moderate, if it is coming as an acute coronary syndrome, one would tend to stent it, and if the person is stable angina, then probably it will not get stented. Angioplasty evolved, and there were now difficult lesions which could not be done by the earlier techniques. There were hard calcific lesions, chronic total occlusions. They were difficult subsets, and angioplasty was not a choice for them. So in came the other modalities like the rotablator, which cuts the calcium, intravascular ultrasound, which looks at the good deployment of the stent, the optical coherence tomography, the CTO instruments, which changed, cutting balloons, hybrid labs. All these are devices which are available in high-end labs, and that results into bigger and bigger success for angioplasty. Okay, this showed you a dense calcification, and this is a rotablator instrument which is going through the calcification. And unless you do the rotablator, balloon cannot be implanted or expanded here. And with the dense calcification, we could still manage a good result because the rotablator could cut the calcium. So rotablator is used more and more often these days because post-bypass patients come, octogenarian patients come, chronic diabetics come. They all have loads of calcium. And unless you do rotablator in these, angioplasty is not useful. Okay, when you have problems related to left main, we use a device called IVUS, the intravascular ultrasound, which actually looks inside the artery like a sonography. And you can make the characteristic of a lesion, whether it is calcific, whether it is thrombotic, whether it is ulcerated. And based on that, you can choose the modality of treatment. And after stenting, if you do the IVUS, it tells us that the stent is well apposed, and good apposition of a stent to the vessel wall is a hallmark of success of angioplasty. Another modality is called FFR, the fractional flow reserve. When you have a moderate lesion like this in a stable lesion, we pass a wire through that, and this wire has a special transducer. Imagine a wire which is 0.014 inch, and it has a pressure transducer which gives us pressure trace before and after the lesion. And when the ratio of FFR, you can see in the yellow, is 0.75, it indicates that the lesion is hemodynamically significant and needs to be stented. Like this one, after stenting, looks great, and the person of course gets relieved of his angina. Another such patient with a FFR of 94.94, if it is under 0.81, we would stent. Above 0.8, we will not stent. Like this one is 0.81. This was also a doctor by profession, but after stenting with FFR, documentation led to relief of his symptoms. 0.89, one would not stent because it means that the lesion is not hemodynamically significant. When you are performing angioplasties, it's a 3 millimeter artery. You are performing about 1 meter away from your hands. You have wires which are steel, actually steel. So it's like holding a snake in your hand. So it can wipe and do a lot of things inside the coronary arteries. The complications could be related to the wires causing perforation, the stent overexpansion, the contrast causing contrast-induced nephropathy. It could be gastrointestinal bleeds. It could be minor things like acute retention, psychosis, cramps, or of course, mortality is always there when you are doing very complex angioplasties. But all put together, these complications are single-digit complications. It could be dissection, thrombus, air embolism, side branch closure, arrhythmias, perforations, and a lot of other things which can go wrong. The blue one is the coronary artery. Inside that is the myocardium, and inside that is the left ventricular cavity. If a coronary perforates inside and the blood goes into the myocardium, you are safe because it will contain the perforation. But if it perforates outside into the pericardium, it will quickly lead to tamponade, and you can lose a patient on table. Complications when occur, probably it is a time when you have to be quick, aggressive, and solve the problem quickly. Tap the tamponade and put in a what is called as a covered stent at the perforation. Unfortunately, nowadays, most cath labs do not have this covered stent, and perforation nowadays is going to be extremely hazardous. Like this lady, a lesion which looked critical in the mid segment. We brought in her stent here and look at the perforation. It is a mark perforation which is expanding into the pericardium. We could manage to save her and send her for surgery because it was too huge a perforation and the surgeon couldn't salvage her later. Whereas this lesion, if you see right at the bottom, around 6 o'clock position, here is a stent which is going down to that lesion. A stent winds around, it is going on to the wire and it reaches its position. And once the stent is deployed, you can see a mountain-like black haze on the top. That is a perforation, but that's in the myocardium, so the person is reasonably safe. He was conserved and did well later on. There could be edge dissection. You expand the stent, but the artery gets narrow distally, and that can cause dissection of the artery. Here is such a patient at a very simple, straightforward lesion in the mid-segment of the LAD. And then we stent it. And after the stenting, look at the proximal part of the stent. It shows a definite dissection. It is overexpanded in that area. So it was another stent is put in that area and a final result looks very good, but at a cost of one extra stent, which is quite expensive. Here is a fracture of the stent. You can make out the stent actually has broken into two pieces. Fortunately, the artery has not broken. But all these complications are known and fortunately they are less than single digit. Labs have changed a lot. Hardware has changed a lot. Angioplasty has become a lot easier. By marginal skills, you can do most of the angioplasties. And for the 10% complex procedure, you need to have the expertise, the guile, and of course the experience to perform this procedure. There's something called a hybrid procedure. That means front of the heart, Lima to give will be given as a graft to the LAD because Lima to LAD is said to be a golden graft and it cannot be matched by anything else. And the posterior arteries like the circumflex and the right coronary artery are stented on the same table. So surgeon and cardiologist work together and give a minimally invasive bypass surgery in the front and angioplasties at the back of the heart. Expensive procedure, but worth it when it comes to some of the patients. After this angioplasty, the patient is observed in the ICU for 24 hours. The sheets are removed maybe in the lab or in the CCUs. Immobilization of the leg for 6 hours. Antiplatelets, low molecular weights are given. Dual antiplatelet therapy and high-dose statin is a must. And dual antiplatelet therapy should be stopped at 1 year in elderly people or people who have high bleeding tendencies, or up to 30 months when such probabilities are not there. Angioplasty has improved leaps and bounds. The results have not improved greatly because more and more complex cases get done. I would say that procedural success is about 97%. It would be best in type A lesions and worst in total occluded segments. Acute stent thrombosis is about 0.6%. Subacute stent thrombosis is 1 in 100. And very late thrombosis also would be 1 in 1,000. In-stent restenosis, ISR, it takes place within 6 months. It is 30% in bare metal stents, 15% in drug-eluting stents, and a single digit in the stage 4 or fourth generation drug-eluting stent would give you a restenosis rate to the tune of 5 to 7%. The Achilles heel or the weak part of any angioplasty procedure as such, where the results are not optimal in inexperienced hands and labs, is left main, bifurcation lesions, long calcific lesions, non-expanding fibrotic lesions, and chronic total occlusions. In these cases, inexperienced people will suffer, and probably sometimes even experienced people, experienced operators, the results may not be optimal. Drawbacks are because the results depend on expertise. So you need to have a reasonable expertise before you perform angioplasties in most of the patient. Every stent will have a single digit failure rate up to 5 to 7%, 9% overall in the first 6 months. Dual antiplatelet treatment is critical up to 1 year. And if somebody is not able to take it for bleeding risk, then angioplasty is not the option for that patient. Very heavy calcification, chronic total occlusions, bifurcations, long diffuse lesions means a less result, successful angioplasty is compared to the other lesions. And it is a relatively expensive procedure because every hardware that you use, every wire, every balloon, every guide catheter, every stent that you use costs in dollars. And that's why this procedure is expensive as compared to some of the surgeries. The positive points are it is a non-surgical procedure. It is done under local anesthesia. Direct angioplasty is the best treatment for acute myocardial infarction today when it is performed in a correct time. And in fact, even most juniors can perform PAMIs very well. Contrary to the popular belief, PAMI is one of the simpler angioplasties. And it is short time off work. After the angioplasty, a person can go back to work in a day or two also sometimes. Further positives are post-PTCA precautions like diet, exercise, compliance to medication, in fact, should be done by every individual, whether it is angioplasty done or not. Repeat procedures are not cumbersome, except for because of cost involved. 50% PTCAs are straightforward. 30% are tricky, but can give good success rate. And 20% only need very special expertise. Question now is what not to do in coronary angioplasty in 2018. Chronic stable angina, moderate lesions, small areas of ischemia, no good documentation, please avoid angioplasties. Complex angioplasties in small centers should be avoided. Delay in PAMIs, more than 2 hours delay should not be there. Cardiologists and team should be available. Perforations should be avoided as of today because covered stents are not there in any of the labs. Inadequate apposition of the stent should be avoided. Inadequate dual antiplatelet cover should be avoided. Excessive DAPT cover in high doses should be avoided because it can cause bleeds. And adequate long-term result, whenever it is in question, angioplasty should be avoided. So the take-home message would be angioplasty is a high success rate procedure. It's magical in acute myocardial infarction. Most lesions, most indications can now be treated with angioplasty. Bypass surgery is now reserved only for extensive diseased cases. It's a relatively expensive procedure. And what should not be treated with PTCA is a more relevant question these days than what can be treated. Thank you. I'm sure we can take some questions. I'm done with my presentation. If you have questions, we'll take them and discuss these question answer session. We already have some questions here. Dr. Deepak Ranjan Das, do you feel that angioplasty has lost some of its sheen after capping of the stent prices? Corporates treat it like any other procedure, not a money-minting exercise. I think we should avoid political questions, but I feel it's not lost the sheen. In fact, best of the stents are now available at a cheaper cost. So why it should lose the sheen? I feel most angioplasties are getting performed with equal fervor as they were performed in the past. Dr. Sanjeev Malhotra, what are the factors causing current stenosis, recurrent stenosis at either end of the stent, not in stentary stenosis? If you have overexpanded on either side, it will result into an injury to the intima, causing what is known as a candy wrapper type of a stenosis. Either side of the stent will get stenosis, because it has caused an injury and it will cicatrize, it will fibrose, and on either side of the stent there will be a restenosis. Multivessel stenting versus bypass, MACE and reintervention after either procedure. If multivessel stenting, the syntax score is less than 28, and if you have enough expertise, multivessel stenting is a choice. If the syntax score is 28, probably it's best to choose bypass surgery, especially in diabetic subsets. There will be more MACE if you perform multivessel angioplasties, less with CABGs, but relief to the patient, less invasive procedure, less surgical risk, less risk of stroke, all these are in favor of multivessel angioplasty. Stent across the origin of a branch vessel, what is your opinion? Very comfortably can be done. If the branch vessel is not diseased, there are 4% chances of something going wrong. If the branch vessel is diseased, there are about 18% chance of something going wrong. But they can be tackled very easily. and an angioplaster worth its salt should know how to manage a side branch. Dr. Mridul Srivastava, how long is it mandatory to continue antiplatelet medication after angioplasty or stenting? One drug or two drugs? What are the current recommendations? For acute coronary syndrome, aspirin remains number one drug. The second antiplatelet would be ticagrelor or prasugrel for acute coronary syndromes. Whenever prasugrel is contraindicated, probably ticagrelor can be used in most of the indication. For chronic stable lesions, which is not acute coronary syndrome, aspirin and clopidogrel still remains the dual antiplatelet of the choice. Most patients should be continued for 1 year definitely. Those who have multiple stents and chances of thrombosis should be continued for 30 months after the angioplasty. And those who have high bleeding chances, they should be stopped at 1 year. That is the current recommendation. Dr. Mrinali Sharma, how to manage antithrombotic therapy before, during, and after emergency angioplasty for STEMI patients? It depends on your choice. Most of the patient, if they are decided to undergo angioplasty, could be loaded nowadays with ticagrelor 180 milligrams or prasugrel 60 milligrams based on your choice. During procedure, unfractionated heparin is used most of the times. After the procedure, low molecular weight heparin is used most of the times. And at the time of the discharge, patient would be on correct dose of aspirin ticagrelor, correct dose of aspirin prasugrel, or correct dose of aspirin clopidogrel based on what dual antiplatelet was used. Dr. Krishnasundar Agarwal, what are the clinical outcomes of angioplasty in diabetic patients with peripheral arterial disease? Diabetic patients who have coronary disease, when they have peripheral arterial disease, that means the disease process is very chronic. These patients are likely to have diffuse disease in the coronaries with calcification. So when you choose such a patient for angioplasty, your intention should be very clear. Relieve a large area of ischemia. If required, use a rotablator or a cutting balloon to use the stent. Treat criticality very well. Expand the stents and oppose them to very vessel wall very well. With scientifically done procedures, you can give a remarkable result to them, knowing fully, as you have already asked the question, that this is a subset which is going to come back to you with restenosis in the future if proper care is not taken. Dr. Navya Gandhi, what about adopting coronary angioplasty as an invasive strategy for in-stent restenosis? Check with every complex angioplasty, check angiogram after a few months. If there are multiple stents and if a patient is on dual antiplatelet therapy for a longer time, probably it's a good idea to do a check coronary angiogram to evaluate for in-stent restenosis. Most of the times, in-stent restenosis announces itself by way of symptoms or by way of non-invasive estimation. I would personally do non-invasive estimation first before going in for coronary angiography. Yeah, I think it was quite a discussion of more than 30 minutes on a procedure which is very close to my heart, because I was amongst the first few in India who started angioplasty. And in the last 27 years, it has evolved to such an extent that this information had to reach to the medical fraternity outside the cardiology field. I'm glad to have presented this to you. I hope you've enjoyed it very well. Thank you very much for your attendance.